The TL-1000R, or otherwise known as the TLR, is a 996cc V-twin superbike developed in 1998 and carried production through till the 2003 model year. Based off of the TL-1000S, a naked version of the R, the TLR packed tons of power, 135 brake horsepower, and 78 foot-pound of torque. The R model had exactly the same engine as the S model, however, the TLR had special components including forged pistons, stronger connecting rods, and a much stiffer frame. The TLR was designed to compete in the World and American Superbike Championships. Although it achieved only one race win before Suzuki pulled the plug on the TL racing program entirely. The TLR was overall a failure. It was designed to win championships, yet it didn't win any championships and only managed to win a single race. Compared to Honda's RC51, which won multiple championships, it was impossible for the TLR to not live in the RC51's shadow. The RC51, especially the SP2 model, which was released in 2002, completely buried the TLR. The suspension and build quality of the RC51 was something that the TLR was significantly lacking. They both did make about the same horsepower, however, the RC51 weighed about 20 pounds less than the TLR. But either way, both bikes were extremely similar, both being a 996cc V-twin with gear-driven cams. However, the suspension wasn't even remotely close, especially the rear suspension, but we'll get back to that later. The TLR did, in theory, have a better brake setup with its 6-piston front caliper and 2-piston rear caliper compared to Honda's 4-piston front and 1-piston rear, although many of the motorcycle magazine testers said that they prefer the Honda's brakes. Something about the TLR requiring too much effort versus the RC51, which had a better overall bite. But now I would like to talk more in depth about Suzuki's TLR build quality. There have been reports from owners that the chain would rub on the left side exhaust and swing arm if not adjusted perfectly, and the mounting tabs are easily broken. These are oversights that Honda didn't make with the RC51, which helped earn its status of having an amazing build quality. Also, to go back on the suspension a little bit, the TLR only had 4.7-inch ground clearance compared to Honda's RC51, which had a 5.1-inch ground clearance. Also, it's unfortunately not as easy as upgrading the TLR suspension because the left midpipe had to be crimped in half to make clearance for the chain and swing arm. Although apparently an aftermarket exhaust would help solve this issue. Upgrading the rear suspension on the TLR was a common mod just because of how bad the stock suspension was. And unfortunately, the suspension wasn't the only difficult thing to upgrade. The TLR engine was not suited properly for making horsepower. When you started approaching that 150 horsepower mark, the crankcases would not hold up and the lower end bearings would fail frequently when taken out of those stock specifications. Whereas people have reported getting over 150 horsepower out of the RC51 without any issues. And finally, I need to talk about the looks. Now, the TLR wasn't a bad looking bike when it first came out in 1998. But the design hasn't aged well. It's far too bubbly, and more importantly, the headlight, which I swear is Suzuki's Achilles heel. Just look how bad and extremely outdated that headlight looks. And when you compare it to the likes of the RC51, it becomes obvious. I just don't understand how somebody could say the TLR looked better than the RC51, and the RC51, in my opinion, just is leaps and bounds better than the TLR in terms of looks. There's not a single part of the TLR that looks better, in my opinion. Some people have complained about the RC51's instrument cluster. I love the digital tachometer, but even I can admit that the TLR's analog tachometer is easier to read at a glance, but I'm not a racer, so I guess I can understand why people would prefer the TLR's instruments over the RC51. And despite the RC51 having better suspension overall and a stronger racing pedigree, the TLR did have a smoother and wider power band and a better fuel range and was considered the better street bike. However, with Suzuki having the reputation of being a discounted Honda, it really wasn't discounted with an MSRP of $9,500 to Honda's $10,000. The $500 you saved probably wasn't enough to justify getting a heavier bike with worse suspension and antiquated technology. And of course, the horrible aesthetics and the no racing pedigree. I cannot imagine people would pick up the TLR over the RC51 simply because it got better fuel range or was a more street-friendly power band, because if you're worried about those characteristics, then you're probably not shopping in this category to begin with anyway. I don't mean to be so crude towards the TLR. It is still, after all, a V-twin superbike, which sounds amazing, and it still performs great despite its shortcomings. In 1998, when it was first developed, it was competitive, and people still do track these TLRs as they are much cheaper than RC51s, and if you dump like a grand or two into one, it could be just as capable as an RC51. In a vacuum, the TLR would have been an amazing bike, but it's hard to claim that when there's just an overall better bike out there on the market. And if you have a TLR, don't be angry. There's no shame in having your bike beaten by the legendary RC51. And during the TLR's tenure, it was my favorite big displacement bike Suzuki was making. Well, besides the Hayabusa, of course. It really is too bad that Suzuki abandoned the TLR. When Honda released the SP1 in 2000, Suzuki should have responded with an upgraded TLR in 2001 or 2002. I'm sure the upgraded model would have fared much better against the Honda's RC51, but Suzuki just did not see the light at the end of the tunnel with this project. It was almost as if Suzuki gave up on the TLR before it had even left the showroom floor in 1998, with no updates at all, and then Suzuki abandoned it in favor of their GSX-R 750 for their racing team. I appreciate what the TLR brought to us, and I appreciate Suzuki for trying something new. I do criticize Suzuki for abandoning it though. The TLR was doomed to fail the second it was created, and during its 5-year run it could never even hold a candle to the RC51, or the Ducati 996, or the Aprilia Mille. And that's just too bad. But after making this video, it's easy to see why the Suzuki TL1000R was forgotten. Thank you all so much for watching. Remember, if you want to see more content like what you just saw, please click on that subscribe button down below, and I'll see you in the next one. Song, I wanna play, alright.